This video is provided as supplementary material for courses taught at Howard Community College. And in this video, I'm going to talk about the conjugate zeros theorem. So the conjugate zeros theorem says this. If P of X is a polynomial having only real coefficients, and if A plus BI is a zero of P, then the conjugate A minus BI is also a zero of P. So here's what this is saying. Imagine you've got a polynomial, which we'll call P of X, and maybe the polynomial is something like 2x to the third minus 5x squared plus 7x minus 4. And you're told that one of the zeros of this polynomial is 2 plus 3i. In other words, one of the zeros is a complex number. It's got an imaginary number in it. Well, if that's the case, then that means there's going to be a second zero, which is the pair to this. It's what we call the conjugate pair. It would be 2 minus 3i. If you were told that one of the zeros was, let's say, just, 4i, then it would mean that you would have a pair, which would be negative 4i. You could think of this as 0 plus 4i, 0 would be the real part, and 0 minus 4i. Okay, but typically we're not going to have to write those zeros in. Okay, so basically all this is saying is that if you have imaginary zeros, they're going to occur in pairs. You're going to have something with a plus, maybe some number and an I, and a minus, and then that same number and an I. Okay, so here's how you typically see it in problems. You make it a problem that says something like this. Find a cubic polynomial in standard form with real coefficients having zeros negative 4 and 3 plus 2i. Okay, so given that conjugate zeros theorem, we know that if we've got one of the zeros is 3 plus 2i, then another zero is going to be 3 minus 2i. And of course, we got that other zero that we were given. That's just negative 4. And we're supposed to write the polynomial out. It's a cubic polynomial, so it's third degree, and we've got three zeros. So that's all we're going to need in terms of how many zeros there are. I'm going to call this P of X. And if we've got 3 plus 2i as a zero, then that means that X minus 3 plus 2i is going to be a factor. And if we've got 3 minus 2i as a 0, then that means that x minus 3 minus 2i is going to be a factor. And finally, if we have negative 4 as a 0, then x plus 4 will be a factor. Now, the only hard part about this is multiplying all this out because they say they want it in standard form. And I think I left out a parenthesis here. Okay, so there's a number of different ways to multiply this out. I'll show you the way I like to do it. If you've got a different way and it works, that's fine. So first I'm going to get rid of the parentheses that I have in here. I'm going to take this x minus 3 plus 2i and turn it into x minus 3 minus 2i. And then the next factor, I'll turn that into x minus 3 plus 2i, and the last factor is still going to be x plus 4. Okay, and now I'm going to put some parentheses back in. I'm going to take this first one, x minus 3 minus 2i, and I'm going to think of that x minus 3 as being just a little binomial all by itself, and then I'll still have this minus 2i. I'll take the next factor, and once again, I'll separate out that x minus 3, and I'm going to have plus 2i. And then I've got the last factor, which is x plus 4. Okay, now, I want to multiply these first two factors together. So what I'm going to do, in a sense, is FOIL them. If I take the first times the first, that's x minus 3 times x minus 3, which basically is x minus 3 squared. If you're not sure about how to do that, just do that somewhere else on your page or on a scrap paper. So x times x is x squared. X times negative 3 is negative 3x. Negative 3 times x is negative 3x. And negative 3 times negative 3 is positive 9. So this is going to turn into x squared minus 6x plus 9. Okay, so that the first times the first is going to be x squared minus 6x plus 9. Let me erase this so I have room at the bottom here. Then I would do the first times the last. That would be this x minus 3 times 2i. So let's just call that plus 2i times x minus 3. And then I would have the inside ones. I would have negative 2i times x minus 3. And then I would multiply the last, the negative 2i times the positive 2i. Well, negative 2 times positive 2 is negative 4. I times I is I squared, and I squared is negative 1. So negative 4 times negative 1 is positive 4. Let's put that whole thing in parentheses, and that's still going to get multiplied by x plus 4. Okay, now I can clean this up quite a bit. I'm going to take this x squared. I'll still have that. I've got this negative 6x plus 9. And you notice I've got a plus 2i times x minus 3 and a minus 2i times x minus 3. So they're going to cancel out. I'm not going to need those at all. Then I've got a plus 4. And that whole thing is still going to get multiplied by x plus 4. I've got a 9 and a 4. I can add those together. So I've got x squared minus 6x plus 13 times x plus 4. Okay, now when I've got multiplication like this to do, I usually like to turn it into a separate form, into a different form. So I'm going to write x squared minus 6x plus 13 times x plus 4. In other words, I'm going to do this like a kind of a long multiplication problem. So I've got 4 times 13. That's, let's see, 2 times 13 is 26, 4 times 13 is 52. 4 times negative 6x is negative 24x, and 4 times x squared is just 4x squared. Now let's multiply the x times 13, so that's 13x. That's positive. X times negative 6x is negative 6x squared. And x times x squared is x to the third. And now I'll just add this up. So I'm going to have x to the third. 4x squared minus 6x squared is negative 2x squared. Negative 24x plus 13x is negative 11x. And then that's plus 52. So p of x would equal x to the third minus 2x squared minus 11x plus 52. Okay, so that would be the cubic polynomial written in standard form. Okay, so let me just review this quickly. The easy part was finding the three zeros. I knew that I had 3 plus 2i, so there was going to be 3 minus 2i, and I had a negative 4 that I was given also. Then I took those three zeros, and I used them to write out the factors for the polynomial. And then the hard part really had nothing to do with the fact that this was the conjugate zeros theorem. It just had to do with the fact that we had to multiply all of this out. So I first got rid of my parentheses, then I put parentheses in different places, multiplied this out, in a sense, by foiling, and then used this kind of long multiplication to get the final answer. Okay, so I hope that helps. Take care. I'll see you next time.